Good afternoon, and welcome to Our Lady Queen of Angels Church as we celebrate this funeral mass for Richard Raymond Lures. Out of respect for the sacredness of the liturgy, please silence all cell phones at this time. Our current restrictions do not allow all of us to sing aloud. Instead, I will sing for all of us, and we invite you to sing in your hearts and minds. Please stand.
Welcome to Our Lady Queen of Angels. All those from the city, from this community, from our parish, know that you are most welcome here today on this very significant day. As we pray for Richard today, we also pray for ourselves and for each other. We ask God's grace and mercy to be with us as we pray in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Then the grace and peace of God our Father, the love of Jesus Christ, His Spirit be with you all, and with your spirit. We bless Richard's remains with holy water, which is a reminder of that foundational moment for a Christian in this life when we are baptized, whether as an infant or as an adolescent or even as an adult, that beginning journey home to the Lord. And so we pray in the waters of baptism, Richard died with Jesus Christ and rose with him. And so may he now share with the Lord eternal glory. Again, welcome here to Our Lady Queen of Angels, and thank you for being here for Susan, for Samantha, for Ricky, for your relationship with Richard. I'm Father Steve Salat, the relatively new pastor here at this parish, but I was here 40 years ago when most of you were still kicking slats out of the cradle, but I'm back again as pastor, and so it is a pleasure to pray with you again today. Let us pray. O God, who have set a limit to this present life so as to open up an entry into eternity, we humbly beseech you that by the grace of your mercy, you may command the name of your servant Richard to be inscribed in the book of life. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. It is our custom at this time to please be seated. And I'd ask if Bill, Jeff, and Michael would please come forward for our eulogies today.
Don't cry because it's over. Smile because it happened. That was Dr. Seuss, and a wonderful memory of Richard. We can all smile because Richard came into all of our lives and made them better. Richard Raymond Lures was born March 21st, 1947, second of six children of William and Cecilia Lures, Cecilia Murawski Lures. We six, me, the oldest, William Jr., Richard, James, Kathy, Debbie, Susan, all grew up on the south side of Milwaukee, humble roots. Our father was a union welder at Alice Chalmers, and our mother was a wonderful homemaker. They both passed away in Southern California, but they lived to their 90s. The homes Richard and I grew up in, I call it humble existence, had but one bathroom for the six kids and the two parents. But it was a happy childhood for us. Our father was a World War II Navy veteran. He belonged to the VFW, and they rented out cottages on a place called Lake Tomahawk in northern Wisconsin. We all learned to love fishing, especially Richard. But early on, he was Dickie Bird. St. Aloysius Catholic Grade School and the Pius Catholic High School, Pius 11th Catholic High School yearbook has him as D. Lures, as in Dick Lures. Pius 11th High School, 1, 2, 3, 4, football, 1, 2. Dickie, as that second oldest, had to find his niche in the family. Since I was the oldest, I was the first lieutenant to my parents to keep the brood in line. Dickie became the rebel. Growing up, he was fond of back talk. He called me Goody Goody Two Shoes because in his eyes, I never did anything wrong according to our parents. I would call him Louis the Lip. We were competitive. I was kind of a little shrimp. Richard grew fast. So the almost 3 years of birth ages were a lot narrower physically. One year, our dad bought us boxing gloves for Christmas, cleared the living room of furniture so we could have at it, duke it out. Growing up, we had paper routes. Our willingness to fight came in handy when the biggest boy at the shack where we collected our 75 newspapers for our delivery route, he was a bully. So Dickie and I ganged up on him one day behind the shack, and the bullying stopped. Another time at Christmas, we thought our 18-year-old cousin, Bill, we were 13 and 10, had disparaged our mother during a poker game. Alice, your turn, Alice. Sometime today, Alice. Of course, her name was Cecilia. So we together took him out in the backyard snow and washed out his mouth with snow. Dick graduated Pius XI in 1965, and he chose to carve out his own path. I had gone on to college, but he joined the Navy like his father. He was stationed in Long Beach. He soon found himself on a destroyer, USS Brinkley Bass, in Vietnam. For 6 years in the Navy, under his belt, and having married his high school sweetheart, they settled in Southern California. Then came that terrible motorcycle accident on his beautiful Triumph motorcycle with the unstable ape hanger handlebars. After the accident, he and his wife split, and I would say he was a rather angry young man. Disabled vet, scraggly beard, handkerchief headband, a little pot smoking here and there. But then there was a transformation. His drive, his inner drive to make things happen in the early years became recognized as a force for good and a force for change. So to drive the communities he cared about, to recognize disabled vets, that they deserved equal chances to succeed. He enrolled at California State Northridge, and immediately joined the push to get handicapped access for all students that attended that school. There were classes when he started that he could not attend because they were on upper floors. He was also the inspiration for Deborah, his sister, who's here with us, to become a physical therapist. He went to the Northridge Hospital Spinal Injury Clinic, volunteered, and to train the physical therapy staff to be able to get back into a wheelchair from a floor by himself. That was an accomplishment that was very difficult, but he showed the physical therapy staff how to do that. In California, he welcomed all of his family members, sisters like Deborah and Kathy, who is also here, who stayed with him as they found their own ways in California. After Northridge, he was a loan officer for Lloyd's Bank for a time, but there were some issues with rather aggressive loan approvals that led to a different career choice for Richard. Nudies. The Western Apparel store catering to the movie stars like John Wayne was his next career. But his uncle Roy was a small business owner in Burbank, got Richard interested in small business affairs like the Chamber of Commerce, and that led to his appointment as the North Hollywood Chamber of Commerce executive. And the rest is history, which you will hear today. Through all of this, we've come to be inspired by Richard, me especially, that he could find a way to overcome challenges that made me think the stuff that was going on in my life was so trivial by comparison. He was my hero. And he accomplished so much. Found and married a terrific mate in Susan, fathered two wonderful children. He always found a way. So we all look up to him. And especially now, as we look up to the heavens, we see him. We see him free of the encumbrances of his compromised body, running again, laughing again, fishing with his father, rooting on the Green Bay Packers, doing all those wonderful things. We are truly happy for him today. I close with a prayer. May all the angels and holy friends of God rejoice at your entrance into the kingdom of heaven. Today, yours is a peace that the world cannot give. Enter into the house of your Father through the merits of his divine Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Love you, brother.
When Susan asked me to share some thoughts about Richard, I was flattered and honored, but mostly I was humbled. As I started thinking of the years I spent working with him, I realized what a huge impact he had had on my life and the lives of so many of you. In just a few minutes, what memories and highlights can I mention about someone who has been such a part of this community for so long? You probably already know many of the details of this man who lived a life of service to Newport Beach, who loved its businesses and worked tirelessly to improve our community. Richard came to the Newport Beach Chamber of Commerce in 1982, and during his 30-year tenure as president and CEO, I had the pleasure of working at his side for more than 20 years. And when I first came to the chamber as a young graphic designer, I had never worked in an office with someone in a wheelchair. And during my first week, we had an event aboard a hornblower cruise. And as we went up to board the boat, Richard politely asked me to help lift him up from the back of his chair so he could get over the door jamb and onto the boat. And I was young, brand new, just wanted to do what my boss asked, so I picked him up. And as I did, I looked down and saw the water below, and also saw the boat slowly inching away from the ramp. I've certainly prayed many times here at church, but nothing like the prayers I made on that dock to please not let me drop my president into the waters of Newport Harbor during my first week. And although that was stressful, I did discover along the way that there were some perks. We had a Christmas staff party at Disneyland one year, and the entire staff collectively rejoiced when we got to have front-of-line privileges since Richard was in a wheelchair. There are some who have worked with Richard even longer than I did, some of whom are here today. But starting my career as a young kid, Richard taught me so many life and business lessons. And in one of our countless chats, I remember asking him, how in the world does everything get done? With so many moving parts in a city, so many different groups with varied opinions and needs, it seemed overwhelming. His answer was, Jeff, decisions get made by good people that show up. And Richard definitely showed up. Over his 30 years, he worked with 4 different city managers, 5 police chiefs, 4 fire chiefs, 27 mayors, hundreds of city council members, thousands of business owners, and over 400 Chamber of Commerce board members and 29 board chairs. Most of us have one boss while we're in a position, but every year he had to roll up his sleeves and work with and for new leadership. To me, that's a testament to his people and leadership skills and his ability to adapt and work with just about anyone towards a common goal. I certainly won't read his whole resume, but I have to mention just a few highlights as so many things in place today stemmed from the Richard leadership provided. He oversaw the creation of Leadership Tomorrow, a program still running today that has educated hundreds of local residents and business professionals about how services are delivered in Orange County. And many of these participants went on to leadership roles like serving on city council and heading up nonprofit organizations. Richard created the Chamber's Taste of Newport, an event that successfully ran for 24 years, drawing literally hundreds of thousands of people, raising millions of dollars for the Chamber, and bringing attention to the outstanding restaurants here in our city. I have never worked so hard in my life as I did during each year's Taste, and I remember at the end every year, sitting in the middle of Newport Center Drive at 3 a.m., sharing a cigar with Richard, and him saying, okay, Jeff, you did great. Now clean all this up. Working with the Chamber Commodores, he championed the Newport Beach Christmas Boat Parade and Ring of Lights and helped raise it to its current status as a world-class event. And being in a wheelchair didn't scare Richard off from getting on a small 10-foot boat to be the first parade safety marshal. And there were so many other firsts, like creating the Fire and Lifeguard Appreciation Party. Richard didn't shy away from trying new things, and he had the ability to make tough decisions in the best interest of who he was serving, even if it meant disagreeing with what was popular. He was appointed to the California Commission on Disability Access by former Governor Schwarzenegger, was chairman for Disabled Boy Scouts of Orange County, and served on the 552 Club Board for Hogue Hospital. He was also heavily involved with Speak Up Newport, a residence group promoting the common good and general welfare of Newport Beach, was on the Conference and Visitors Bureau Board, and chaired the Orange County Citizens Against Lawsuit Abuse. But in the Chamber of Commerce world, Richard was viewed as a tribal elder and served as president of just about every chamber association there is. At conferences, I was viewed as the lucky guy who got to work with Richard. But I think the honor most telling was when Richard was recognized as Executive of the Year out of over 750 chamber executives throughout the Western United States. Richard was also very involved here at Our Lady Queen of Angels. He served as vice chair of the parish council and was a strong supporter of the parish school from which both Samantha and Ricky graduated. He and Susan were instrumental in the school's auction fundraisers, and even before our kids attended school here, I remember helping him behind the scenes as he took the lead on the Friday fish bakes during Lent. My family doesn't even like seafood, but somehow Richard managed to get us to attend. So yes, Richard did a lot of showing up and got others to show up too. But most importantly, spending the amount of time together that we did every day, you can't help but have a personal relationship. You see many ups and downs, people at their best, sometimes their worst. I certainly saw the great things that Richard did and the long list of accomplishments he achieved. But I also had the privilege of seeing who Richard was, where his heart was through his actions, in between all the committee meetings, dealing with reporters and budgets and managing the chamber. He was one of the most dedicated and committed people I have ever known. And Richard also showed up for me. He was my mentor, both professionally and personally. And I felt privileged to get to watch Ricky and Samantha grow up and hear about their successes and sometimes mischief. Mostly Ricky, actually. In fact, it was pretty much all Ricky for that part. But Richard and Susan have been with our family along our journey and part of so many of our decisions. He and Susan met at a chamber event, and that's how I met my wife as well. He offered advice when we were deciding to send our kids here to Our Lady Queen of Angels School and to join this parish. He went with me to help pick out the engagement ring for my wife. And to be honest, he even helped find my wife, as she worked at a neighboring chamber, and he and their chamber exec worked together to get us to start dating. And he even gave me some of his gray hair. Richard loved his family. He loved this community. He served this parish and school. He loved his friends. I have always looked up to Richard for all of these things, and I think I always will. I guess now I just have to look a little higher.
My wife Susan and I have been friends with Richard and Susan for over 20 years. We met through Our Lady Queen of Angels, where our kids went to school together. Samantha, a year ahead of my Jennifer, Ricky and Sabrina in the same grade. One of the reasons Richard and I got along so well was because of our heritage. Richard, being from Wisconsin, always strongly believed that he had some German in him. As proof, he would occasionally throw out a German word, something like Sindelfiddle, for which I could only give him a blank stare. Nevertheless, he never gave up trying, convinced that he spoke German. As many of you know, Richard loved sports with his favorite team being the Green Bay Packers. He convinced my daughter to become a Packers fan, and when we went through our photos the other day, Sabrina pointed out her favorite one. The two of them in their Packers outfits. Richard had painted his face green with the Green Bay G on his face. He was so proud that he had painted the G facing the correct way by himself sitting in front of a mirror. Richard also liked the Lakers, having played basketball himself as a kid. I am sure that he is now playing hoops with Kobe. There's only one sport we could never agree upon. I could not convince him that soccer is a real sport. Of course, I would be remiss to not mention one of his favorite pastimes, poker. We discovered our passion for watching poker on TV and decided to start our own regular game night. With several Our Lady Queen of Angel dads and other friends, we played a friendly game twice a month just to have a fun evening and a good cigar for some of us. Richard and I ran into the issue of having to answer questions by our wives the next day. How was the game? What did you talk about? Did you win or lose any money? Richard found a quick cure for the last question. When he had a winning night, he would leave a few dollars on the kitchen countertop for Susan to buy a cup of coffee on the way to work. When we started our poker group, my passion for spreadsheets took over, and I kept track of all the winnings, with the top three players receiving a bracelet at the end of the year. When he got his bracelet 1 year, he unfortunately had to spend some time at Hoag Hospital. While visiting him, we noticed that he had taken off all jewelry but the Player of the Year poker bracelet. I could go on for hours telling stories, but I want to end with my personal favorite moment with Richard. A few years ago, I finally received my US citizenship, and Richard drove to Los Angeles with us. Richard, being Richard, wheeled himself in the aisle all the way up to the front and the rope just to shake my hand when I was walking by. He was so proud of me. In summary, Richard was an outstanding community leader. After all, he was Mr. Newport Beach. A terrific husband, a wonderful father, and my best friend. I love you, Richard.
Thank you, gentlemen. Thank you for your sharings and your reflections on Richard. Jen, would you like to come forward for our first scripture? We open now our sacred scriptures that have been chosen for today.
A reading from the prophet Isaiah. Arise, shine, for your light has come. The glory of the Lord has dawned upon you. Though darkness covers the earth, the thick clouds, the peoples. Upon you the Lord will dawn, and over you his glory will be seen. Nations shall walk by your light, kings by the radiance of your dawning. Raise your eyes and look about. They all gather and come to you. Your sons from afar, your daughters in the arms of their nurses. Then you shall see and be radiant. Your heart shall throb and overflow. For the riches of the sea shall be poured out before you. The wealth of nations shall come to you. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Pray, if you'd please come forward for our next scripture.
A reading from the second letter to Timothy. For I am already being poured out like a libation, and the time of my departure is at hand. I have fought the good fight, I have finished the race, I have kept the faith. From now on, the crown of righteousness awaits me, which the Lord, the just judge, will award to me on that day. And not only to me, but to all who have longed for his appearance. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Please let us now stand to greet the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ.
Praise to
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ, King.
My sisters, my brothers, the Lord be with you.
With your spirit.
Reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. John. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus went on to say to the people, "Everything that the Father gives me will come to me, and I will not reject anyone who comes to me, because I came down from heaven not to do my own will, but the will of the one who sent me. And this is the will of the one who sent me, that I should lose nothing of what he gave me, but that I should raise it up on the last day. For this is the will of my Father, that everyone who sees the Son and believes in him may have eternal life, and I shall raise him on the last day." The gospel, the good news of our Lord Jesus Christ. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Please, if you would, be seated for a moment. Thank you for your sharings today. And Bill, I would just say that hopefully when it comes time for my brothers to eulogize me, that they be so kind. I doubt it. Susan, Samantha, the Welsh girl, and Ricky, and those who are watching us virtually as family and friends, all of us gathered here today, thank you again for being here. This is what I would reflect today about Richard and about us. You know, Catholics sometimes can kind of get an isolationist mindset, that somehow our world, the line somehow that's magically created between religion and civil life is somehow distinct. Now, they might have separations by law, but the heart of a real Catholic is engagement in the world as it is around us. It's not to hide from it. It's not to run to the desert or to some mountaintop and find a place of isolation far from the turmoil and the pandemonium of life as it is. Instead, for us as Catholic Christians, our lives, our faith intersects with a larger community when we are at our best. Now, without giving too much away, but Bill, you kind of implied it. No, you actually said it. Richard, when he got started, didn't intersect real well with high school. I think he did pretty well in the Navy. That kind of got him refocused, but he obviously had some things he had to work out. A guy with a strong will had to find that he had to bend it and allowed it to be bent before he could really take that step into the deeper parts of life. And so that is what happened. And that's why his friends, his co-workers can get up today and say all these true and real engagements of Richard in our community here of Newport Beach and indeed far beyond. A lot of people, even as Catholics, who say that's the last thing I want to do is be on the pastor's parish council. But he did it. A lot of Catholics will say, hey, I send my kids, I pay tuition, I send them to Catholic school, but ask me to be involved? Oh, I don't think so. But Richard did. I think it's because he realized how his life intersected with the larger community. In other words, he wanted to play big. And he did. And for the last 3.5 years that I've been here as pastor until recently, Saturday night, 5 o'clock Mass, his life intersected with a larger community over here, right to my left or your right, where he would receive communion when he came to Mass. You know, it is interesting sometimes, again, as Catholics, sometimes our perception is that we avoid life, but instead what we really try to do is engage it deeply. So in this church today, where we pray for Richard, we just heard a little while ago after our morning mass, the little confessions of second graders for the first time. It was great. Even for an old guy like me at 67, I like hearing what little kids have to say about their lives and how they do or don't intersect. This afternoon, we have a wedding here in this church, significant moment where people's lives intersect. When we as Catholics are at our best, we intersect deeply and powerfully with the world around us. Now, that first reading that Jen proclaimed, that reading from Isaiah, it's not one that's often used at funerals. It's usually done right before Christmas. It's the prophetic sayings of Isaiah looking forward to someday a Savior, Jesus. So I'm sure sometimes Richard had to promote himself as the Savior. I can fix your problem. I can fix this issue. But the truth of it is, I think he really knew who the Savior really was. He just worked for him. The second scripture from St. Timothy is about St. Paul at the end of his life in prison. I have run the race. I've run the long course of things, and my time is coming to an end. So St. Paul's in prison. He's writing to his friends. Because of an accident that took place long, long time ago, Richard was in a certain sort of prison, and you guys reflected that. Now, it could have remained a prison to be in a chair, but Richard turned it into a platform for his life. And I think it's because that moment or that time of recovery and interior reflection allowed him to grow to make that chair not a prison for his life, as it does for many people, but for a platform to be really big in this life. Whether it was in a community event, community action, or whether it was as simple as being out there in the garage smoking them big cigars, talking to the little kids on the street who came by to see that guy in a chair with a big cigar. It didn't make any difference. He used it as his platform. And finally, St. John's Gospel. You know, it's all about, I come to do the will of my Father. I don't know about you, but I find it's tough enough to manage my own will and my own needs and desires and kind of the way I perceive things. And it's really only a prayerful person that can begin to see beyond one's own reality and begin to perceive reality as God sees it, as God desires it to be. Richard caught that insight in his life. And that's why to be an advocate for those who are disabled or disadvantaged in any way led him to a place where maybe that's exactly how God sees this thing called reality. Richard had deep faith, and he did his best, even to strengthen his lungs when he was in the hospital by saying as loud as he could, Hail Marys, until they told him in the hospital, stop. You're wearing yourself out. He prayed that the will of the Father might become his. And finally, I would just suggest this. Part of what makes anybody remarkable is the people they hang around with. You're part of the reason why Richard was such a remarkable man. And Susan, and Samantha, and Ricky, you are very much part of the reason why your father and your husband was such a remarkable man. Thank you. And so today we give that remarkable man back to the author of life, Almighty God, the one who gifted him with us in this life. Sabrina, would you like to come forward for our prayer of the faithful? And I'd ask everyone, if we could, to please stand. Our response together will be, Lord, hear our prayer.
For Richard, who in baptism was given the pledge of eternal life, may he now be admitted into the company of the angels and saints. Let us pray to the Lord. Richard showed much love for others in his life. May he now experience the loving mercy of God. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For Richard's family, especially his wife Susan, his children Samantha and Ricky, and his siblings, Bill, Jim, Kathy, Deborah, and Susan, may they find strength and comfort by reaping the fruits of what Richard sowed with love. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all our deceased relatives and friends, and especially for Richard's parents, Cecilia and William, his Aunt Nettie, his Uncle Richard, his mother-in-law Libby, and his sister-in-law Kitty, may God bring them into the light of his presence. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For peace, healing, and understanding within our church, country, and community, and blessings for veterans and the disabled. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all families suffering from the COVID pandemic, may they be comforted and may healing remedies and vaccines bring an end to the current pandemic. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
In gratitude for the tireless work and compassionate care given by healthcare workers, and most especially the medical staff at our VA hospitals, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That each of us believe that we are precious to God and that he has our names written on the palms of his hand. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Gracious and merciful Lord, we lift you the many prayers we offer you this day through Christ our Lord. Amen. If you would please be seated. Pray then, my sisters, my brothers, that my sacrifice and yours this day may be truly acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands, to the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all God's holy church. Please stand. Be near, O Lord, we pray, to your servant Richard, on whose funeral day we offer you the sacrifice of conciliation, so that should any stain of sin have clung to him, or any human fault have affected him, it may, by your loving gift, be forgiven and wiped away. We ask you this through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God in Christ. In Jesus, the hope of blessed resurrection has dawned, that those saddened by the certainty of dying might be consoled by the promise of immortality to come. Indeed, for your faithful Lord, life is changed, but not ended. And when this earthly dwelling turns to dust, an eternal dwelling is made ready for them in heaven. And so with angels, archangels, with thrones and dominions, we proclaim the hymn of your glory. Holy, holy, holy Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. You either may kneel or be seated at this time. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dew, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, Jesus took the chalice and, once more giving thanks, he gave the cup to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." This mystery of our faith, we proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again. Therefore, as we celebrate the memory of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, this bread of life and this chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we too may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. And so remember, Lord, your church, spread it throughout this world. Bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, Kevin, our Bishop, all your holy people. Remember your servant, Richard, whom you have called from this world to yourself. Grant that he who was united with your Son in a death like his may also be one with him in his resurrection. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, all those who have died in your mercy. Welcome them, Lord, into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, the Mother of God, with Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles, indeed all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we too may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. For it is through him, with him, and in him, O O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Amen. Please, if we could stand. It is really prayer that unites us in faith, and so with Jesus and with his church, we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin, safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, the glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus, the night before you gave your life over to the cross, you said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you." And so we ask, Lord, that you look not so much upon our sinfulness, rather upon the faithfulness of your church. Graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. May then the peace of the Lord be with you always. May we share with each other for a moment, safely, of course, a sign of the Lord's peace. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, grant us your peace. Behold then the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. O Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof. Only say the word, my soul shall be healed.
If you are Catholic and wish to receive communion, or are joining us from another faith tradition and desire a blessing, we ask that you cross your hands like this if you're from another faith tradition. We ask that you come forward one pew at a time, allowing 6 feet between households. We also ask that you receive communion only in your hand, and to leave your mask on, then step aside to consume the host. Thank you.
Thank you.
Grant, we pray, Almighty God, that your servant Richard, who has journeyed from this world, may by this sacrifice be cleansed and freed from any sin, and so receive the everlasting joys of the resurrection. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Richard's burial will be Monday morning with just kind of a family and a few close friends. And so I just want you to know at the end what we have is now what is called the final commendation and farewell. And then we will have the presentation of the American flag by our Navy personnel. But just a last thought, I'm reading a book right now about Churchill during the Battle of Britain. And I just couldn't help but think, Richard Churchill, that big cigar, somehow. Trusting in the Lord, we have prayed together for Richard, and now we come to our last farewell. It is true that there is sadness in parting. But we also take comfort in the hope that one day we shall see him again and enjoy his friendship, running, dancing, laughing. May the mercy of God gather us together again in the joy of his kingdom. Therefore, let us console one another in the faith of Jesus Christ. And so into your hands, O Father of mercies, we commend our brother Richard in the sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, he will rise with Jesus on the last day. We give you thanks for the blessings which you bestowed upon Richard in this life. They are signs to us of your goodness and of our fellowship with the saints in Christ. Merciful Lord, turn toward us, listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to your servant. Help us who remain to comfort one another with assurances of faith until we all meet in Christ and are with you and with our brother Richard forever. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God then bless us this day, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. I would ask now if our honor guard would please proceed.
Attention. Ready? Pose.
So we are very honored to be here today to present final military honors for our fallen shipmate, Petty Officer Richard Raymond Lures. We will play taps for him. During the playing of taps, I would ask that only if you can, to please stand and place your right hand over your heart. If there's any former or current military present, you may render a final hand salute. And then we will present the national ensign to the American flag to his beloved next of kin. With that, I would ask that you please rise.
Thank you.
After the family has departed, please exit starting with the back pews. To help keep everyone socially distanced, use the side aisles. Thank you.